well tonight. We are hoping to open up discussions about the Irish people's involvement in the World War I. There's a big appetite for it, following on from our last year's event for the cause of Ireland. We had Mary Lou, and we're very happy tonight to have our very own MLA, Chris Hazard, down with us. We're hoping to respectfully remember the Irish men's sacrifice during the war, and we're following on from Connolly's words, we serve neither King nor Kaiser.
Obviously, potentially controversial topics. How do you find people discuss them in this sort of atmosphere?
Well, we're hoping that it will be a very respectful conversation, that it will open up the debate. Obviously, we acknowledge that Irish people did sacrifice their lives in the war. We understand that it can be controversial here in the North. But we are hoping for a very good debate, and we hope that everybody enjoys it.
Just to bring it back to the neither King nor Kaiser, but Ireland, I think, was the rest of it, which flew outside Liberty Hall, the headquarters of the fledgling Irish Transport and General Workers Union, founded by Connolly and Larkin. Born out of strife, which was not unknown to Northern Ireland, not known to Belfast, not known to Liverpool. It came with the industrialisation of major cities and the migration of rural workers in their droves to industrial cities to find a living. And I suppose, asking ourselves today, does that banner have any relevance today in Ireland, on the island of Ireland? And that's the question which has been posed to me, rather than a historical context in relation to it. I suppose the class-conscious Irish Congress of Trade Unions was born out of that turmoil, which was 1913. And are there lessons for the trade union movement, or simply is it a slogan deeply rooted in the past and therefore, not really relevant today? So where does the Irish left stand today? I suppose if a banner could be flown over Liberty Hall today, different type of Liberty Hall, but if a banner could be flown over that building today, what might it read? I suppose it could read, we serve neither bondholder nor troika, but the people. That might be a good banner to fly over Liberty Hall at the moment. It's not flying over Liberty Hall at the moment, and that's maybe part of the problem for the Irish left, let alone Liberty Hall. And would a banner such as that flying over Liberty Hall, or indeed the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, would that presuppose that there is an existence, a class consciousness in the Irish trade union movement? And I think you have to kind of examine as to whether the Irish trade union movement has a class consciousness anymore. So just looking back a little bit in terms of the revolutionary era, the banner and the conflict and World War I was set in. And as I said, the industrialisation of major cities in the UK and Ireland in the 1900s led to a major conflict between capital and labour. And the existing trade union structures at the time were craft-based, not class-based. They were craft-based. It was a control of entry into particular crafts, nothing to do with class. But the migration of thousands of unskilled workers to major cities posed a problem for the trade union movement, as it was, because it was a craft-based organisation. And until a new trade unionism came along in the form of Jim Larkin and Larkinism, founded in Liverpool, the National Dock Labourers Union, which migrated to Belfast, which created and formed in Belfast, and he organised in Belfast in 1907, and had a very successful strike in 1907, the dock workers' strike in Belfast, mostly with the Protestant working class who worked in the docks, supported by the Catholic working class, which also led to a police mutiny at the time, which was a very successful strike, which was vehemently opposed by the capitalist class in Belfast at the time, in particular the Gallagher family, who were a very strong merchant family in Belfast. So I think that the existing trade union structures at the time were unable or indeed unwilling to accommodate the great unwashed of unskilled labour which arrived in the cities. They seen it as a threat. And I kind of argue a little bit later that maybe things haven't changed all that much, really, when you look at the silo mentality of a lot of trade unions at the moment in terms of their professionalism and looking after their own square feet or their own place of employment or whatever. So Larkin arrives, to say, and he replaced that craft consciousness with a class consciousness. He arrived in Dublin. He organised the same unskilled workers in Dublin that were in Belfast. He organised the tram workers, he organised the porters and the docks, and he organised the dockers themselves. And again, for the first time in Dublin, we had the embryonic existence of a class conflict between capital and labour. And he also set up, after the attacks on the strikers, the Irish and Citizen Army, which was a defence militia to defend striking workers and to defend working class action, which, you know, had a role to play later on in 1916, in the rebellion in 1916. I think all of which developed the trade union family into a movement, or certainly there was a new movement, or the trade unionism became a movement. It became a class movement at that point in time. And that's why I believe that the likes of William Martin Murphy, the owner of the Irish Independent, the owner of the tramway company, the owner of many businesses in Dublin, and that's why the Gallagher family in Belfast, they understood that this was a moment in history which was dangerous for their class, for their ruling elite. And that's why they set out so viciously to destroy the organisation of a class union in Belfast, and indeed in Dublin and Liverpool and further afield. And I think that kind of summarises that the right identified it as a social movement for radical change, which is the first time that, I suppose, trade unionism had been identified as a transformational force within society. As I said, heretofore it was bricklayers, carpenters looking after their trade and handing their trade down to their family or relations or whatever else. Then the great call up in 1914 came, as the song goes, I think. So working class men, mostly men, from all parts of Dublin joined the forces to go and fight in the First World War for many different reasons. Many, many different reasons. Probably all of them valid. To strengthen the union, Carson's call to strengthen the union. We'll give them a debt of blood that they will never, that they'll never be able to betray. Redmond's call in the Republic for you're fighting for home rule. You die for home rule. The economic reasons, people in Dublin and Belfast who simply had no work, who were starving and living in tenements, who had no other option, economic option, but to sign up. Many of those workers were workers who were locked out during 1913, who were blacked, who couldn't get jobs in Dublin or beyond Dublin. And the only option he had was to join the British forces and fight in the First World War. So there's many reasons, and all of them valid, and I think all of them deserve to be remembered, if not glorified, but certainly deserve to be remembered. I think that Connolly and Larkin, in particular, developed a radical working-class trade union movement which challenged the distribution of wealth. And I think that's maybe something which is lacking in the modern-day trade union movement. We don't challenge the distribution of wealth. And we certainly don't challenge it by politicising and by challenging the industrial kind of elite industrially. We don't have sympathetic strikes anymore. Frankly, they're, as you know, since the docker strike in Liverpool and recent docker strike in Liverpool, a lot of them are now illegal. Secondary action is illegal. Sympathetic strikes are illegal. Strikes over individual workers being targeted and striked or been sacked are now illegal. We don't necessarily have civil disobedience campaigns or mobilization campaigns. And we don't really have a politics in the trade union movement. We like to describe ourselves as a broad church. It really means nothing, really. It's kind of a cop-out. I think all that culminated in the involvement of the Irish Citizen Army in the 1916 rebellion, the publication of then one of the most radical documents in the history of Ireland, which was the 1919 Democratic Programme, which was a socialist programme for government, which followed on from the Russian Revolution, which spoke about the ownership of natural resources, which put property rights secondary to the rights of the citizen. And that was followed by a civil war. And the big loser in the civil war in Ireland was the labour movement, was the fledgling labour socialist opposition. Because when it came out of civil war, the petty bourgeoisie took over, the shopkeepers, the innkeepers, the small business people. They were the people who inhabited the positions of power. You know, someone said, I can't remember who, but, you know, you can just paint the letterboxes, and we still have them, just paint them green over the red, and that's exactly what actually happened. So there was no social revolution as such. And not only that, but the incumbent petty bourgeoisie were very hostile to the cause of labour at the time, and still are. And that was reflected in our various constitutions from 1922 onwards, and all the variations of that, but the rights and the general rights of labour were, you know, basically omitted from those constitutions. So, what have we in the left left, I suppose? Well, we have a two-state solution. That's what we have. Honestly, neither of which are really viable. The northern state, which is dependent on handouts from the UK, be it block grants or otherwise, it's no economic policy that I can see, no economic development policy. And it's devoid of any real economic kind of direction. The southern state, which has never been able to provide for its own people, which has tittered on the edge on at least three occasions in the 1920s and the 1950s, and most recently during the financial crash of 2008, had never been able to accommodate all its people. It's like Northern Ireland, it has depended on mass immigration from its shores because it cannot develop an economic model that can support all its people. So the non-resolving of the national question has been a major issue, which, you know, has inhibited the development of, I believe, class consciousness in Ireland. I think that, you know, the welfare reform agenda in the north at the moment is a choice between bread and roses or flags and parades. Frankly, I'm on the side of bread and roses. I don't understand how working class Protestants and working class Catholics or loyalists and nationalists aren't fighting on the same side. Why there's a lack of unity and social solidarity across class in relation to these savage cuts which will be imposed. They've been imposed on the most vulnerable communities in Northern Ireland, already the most deprived region in the UK, and indeed on the UK and the island of Ireland. So it's hard to understand in a historical context. Well, it's not in a historical context, but you can see because the national question has inhibited really that debate. So people would prefer to talk about flags and parades rather than the deprivation of the working class, regardless of what side of the national question they stand on. I also think that the trade union movement has lost its class consciousness. Trade union movements work in silos. They very rarely look over the parapet and look for a transformational challenge to the ruling elite. We're happy to operate as self-interest sectional groups looking after either public servants or retail workers or bricklayers or whatever the case may be. We don't have a thread which knits us all together as a movement for social change. And too often, our individual concerns have been at the expense of the broader good and the betterment of the most vulnerable in our society when we decide that, you know, our members are more important than the broader aspiration of a fairer, better society. So I'd ask myself, is it a movement? Because a movement kind of suggests that you're going somewhere, doesn't it? Kind of, if you're moving, you're going somewhere. It might be back, it might be forward, it might be sideways. But ask yourself, you know, where is the movement, the trade union movement? Where is it going? Or is it just a collection of people standing still, doing the best they can, and they are doing the best they can, for their own individual group of members? Far from the concept of industrial trade unionism that Connolly had, far from challenging the powerful elite, far from challenging the system. And are we comfortable in that? I mean, in the Republic of Ireland, we had 30 years of social partnership. We were brought into government buildings every 3 years and we sat down and fed with biscuits and tea and coffee and sat in the Taoiseach's office and we decided taxation policy and we decided welfare policy and investment policy and pay increases and very important people we were. That went on for 3 decades. And then, you know, we were all talking to each other, farmers, employers, government, et cetera, et cetera. And the crisis hit in 2008. The first people to walk away were the employers. See us, our priorities now are self-preservation. We're out of here. And we looked around as a trade union movement, what was left of it, for our activists. And one of the biggest criminal things that we did in 30 years of social partnership is we ignored our activists. And we looked behind us to see where our troops were, where our shop stewards were. They weren't there anymore because we'd ignored them for 30 years. The pay increases were falling out of the sky. They were coming from government. We hadn't invested in our members. We hadn't invested in putting forward our activists. We hadn't invested in the day that we all knew would happen, that social partnership would end. So we were left on a pitch with no players. And we got the you-know-what kicked out of us. And we're rebuilding slowly now, very, very slowly. Now we've gillions of resources. 30 years with no strikes. 30 years of membership subscriptions coming in on an annual basis. And we couldn't even see that this would end someday. And someday we might have to fight. And someday we might need good shop stewards and good activists and good political education, etc. We didn't do it. Including our own union, by the way. I take responsibility for my own union as well. So, I mean, in terms of where we are at the moment, there is certainly a move. If you're to believe the polls at the moment, and there is only one poll that matters, that's an old political cliche, but for the first time since the foundation of the Free State, or the Irish Republic, since the first time of the foundation of the Irish Republic, there is a realistic opportunity in creating a leftist centre government. We now have, according to the polls, we have more people who will vote for leftist centre parties or individuals than will vote for pro-austerity parties. That is a seismic change. And that is something that we let slip through our hands as a trade union movement. It'll be fatal and detrimental. I think just beholding on ourselves in the trade union movement and parties at the left to come together with a strategy to develop an alternative policy for a different future and a different vision, north and south. I'd like to think that there was a similar type development in Northern Ireland, that if tomorrow there was an election, that there would be a majority of Northern Ireland kind of electorate would vote for the left, and we could have a real alternative of policies, of socialist policies, of social justice. Unfortunately, I think the national question has inhibited that. It's inhibited the development of that cross-community social solidarity, the sectarianism, the post-conflict environment, the conflict environment. And so maybe it's not just quite there yet in Northern Ireland, but I would like to think over a period of time that we can work on that on the island of Ireland and create an economic social unit on the island of Ireland, which is based on social justice and fairness. And that's something which the trade union movement has to take a central role in. I'm not going to say too much more, just in terms of, I mean, the Irish government, albeit with a gun to the head or a gun not to the head in terms of the bailout, we paid 64 million, billion, sorry, billion, at the bondholders. Every bank was deemed too big to fail. Every man, woman, and child in the Republic of Ireland has a debt of in excess of 9,000 euros hanging over their head. Last year, we paid back 7 billion in interest, and interest only. We won't start to touch the principal of the debt until 2038. I thought I was going to say 28, 38, it's even worse. My grandchildren will be only hacking into the principal eventually. We are a very unfair, unjust, and an equal society in the Republic. We still have emigration levels in the region of 50,000 a year. We still have the highest proportion of people either not at work or in low work, in other words, part-time employment. And that tends to be forced part-time employment. Not people who want to work part-time, which is different. People who are forced to work part-time because employers, many of them extremely wealthy, profitable multinationals, who could offer decent jobs and decent conditions, but choose not to. rather they'll offer precarious employment, part-time jobs, subsidised by the state to family income supplements and rent supplements, etc., etc. So social transfers to subsidise big multinational retailers to pay dividends to their shareholders and their international investors. And there's something wrong with that. And that's why this whole debate about the equalisation of corporation tax north and south, it's a farce, really. Have a look at what happened in the leaks from Luxembourg recently. The effective rate of corporation tax in Ireland, in the Republic of Ireland, the headline rate is 12.5%. The effective rate, what you actually pay, is less than 4%. And in fact, if you look at the double Irish and running it through Luxembourg and all, it's zero on many occasions. So you can't compete with that. So if someone goes to 10, they'll still be at zero. So, I mean, it's not really an economic policy just to have a policy created on tax kind of cooperation or tax kind of competition. At the end of the day, tax competition in Ireland is depriving working class families in the US or somewhere else of a social contribution and a decent kind of living. Just a little bit on the water charges thing. It's not really about water charges, really, at the end of the day. It's about people saying enough's enough. It's about we're mobilising around water charges. We've had over, I think someone said a million or a half. We've had over 350,000, 400,000 people on the streets, ostensibly organised by 5 unions. But in reality, with a lot of political parties, progressive political parties involved, but also local communities taking control. So we had one monster demonstration. We thought we were going to get 10,000 people. We got 100,000 people. Then we had another event. We said we'd organise local demonstrations around the country. We didn't print leaflets. We didn't give them resources. We said it's your responsibility on your street, in your house in the state, in your community, to organise yourselves and to start creating a movement. The movement, on the face of it, is about water, but reality is about saying enough's enough. What sort of a vision for Ireland do we have? And it's challenging the political elite, and it's rocked them to their very, very core. They're scrambling around on a day-to-day basis, moving the goalposts, trying to placate the protesters, and they haven't succeeded. I think the whole question of mobilising and organising is the challenge for the trade union movements. It's mobilising, organising, agitating, a movement for social and political change. And I think, you know, still too many unions right across the Irish trade union movement, the public sector and indeed in the private sector, are protectionist organisations. They are the old craft unions. They still have the craft mentality. They have no class mentality, no class consciousness. I think that is the challenge for the trade union movement. The referendum, we are struggling to have a referendum on the ownership of our natural resource, which is water. I think we might actually get a referendum on water. I think we will win. If we get one, we'll win it. But it opens up a bigger debate. Water is one thing, but it's about public ownership. Public ownership of our resources, of our natural resources, the non-commodification of our natural resources. And that's the debate we need to get on the table, rather than everything has a value, everything has a price. Somebody somewhere, some hedge fund or some vulture fund, puts a price on it and moves in and makes a profit on it. I mean, that's the type of debate that we're trying to steer it through. So, can the trade unions, and back to the original question, can the trade unions remain non-political, which essentially we are non-political? I suppose yes, we can. But it won't be a movement. We'll be back in that silo mentality. The movement of Larkin and Connolly and the new unions in which rocked the ruling elite in Belfast and Dublin has to be rebuilt. A great success of the new movement is, I mean, I think as the success of a new movement emerges, I think the real question that will be asked about, as it becomes more successful, the question that will be asked will be the very nature of politics on this island of Ireland, the very nature of the relationship between the Irish Republic and Northern Ireland and Northern Ireland and the UK and UK and Ireland. As we challenge politically, those questions come to the fore. I think the trade union movement has been unwilling to get involved in that space, probably because they didn't want to split, didn't want this unity. It was a conflict situation on the island of Ireland. But I think we need to challenge that space. We need to ask those questions, the nature of the relationship, the power relationships, the elite relationships, the capital relationships that tie that capital system on the island of Ireland and how it interlinks with the UK, the EU and further afield in terms of globalisation. So I think, you know, the trade union movement since Larkin and Connolly has never really confronted the class question. I think it has to confront the class question. And the class question on an all-Ireland basis. I don't think you can do it in Northern Ireland. I don't think you can do it in the Republic of Ireland. I think you need to do it on the island of Ireland. I think we need to do it together in solidarity. So again, just finally, just in terms of we serve neither King nor Kaiser but Ireland, I think that question actually still goes to the very heart of the debate of class and power in Ireland, North and South. It's still relevant today as it was then. It goes to the very, very heart of our relationship, of the capitalist relationship and the relationship between capital and labour and the ruling elite. And the question does need to be confronted, but it needs to be confronted in the spirit of cross-community class solidarity with a vision for a new Ireland, a new order, and I would say a new democratic programme. And if it's my choice, I'll always choose bread and roses. So thank you.
But in the left in Ireland and actually throughout the world recognised the war for what it was. People like Sylvia Pankhurst and Charlotte Despard from Britain, Hannah Shea Skeffens from Ireland, and Keir Hardy and John McLean from Scotland. McLean, of course, were imprisoned for his activities. Karl Liebknecht in Germany was imprisoned. And James Connolly, of course, were among those socialists who were anti-war. And as the German Clara Zetkin put it, it's war against war. That was the main slogan that she was actually promoting through the international women's movement at that time. Alexander Kollontai summed up the ideas when she said in 1915, you would sacrifice your life for a landowner, a factory owner or a wealthy boss. But today it's war and you stab, cripple and kill the enemy, a worker or peasant as ill-fated as you. And you will sacrifice your own life and destroy that of a comrade for another country for the benefit of a common enemy, the millionaire. So the common enemy was not the German or the Brit or the Englishman or the Irishman. The common enemy was the wealthy, the class. As John said, it's a class issue. Connolly, of course, wrote quite a lot on this as well. And he echoed these views when he said that, I believe the socialist proletariat in all Europe, in all belligerent countries, ought to have refused to march against their brothers across frontiers. And such a refusal would have prevented this war. These socialists who live miles apart from each other gave a similar analysis to the First World War and identified the common struggle of the working class. And they pointed out that arms production, the most lucrative branch of every industry at that time, had become a national and international force in itself, acting as an incentive to war. As Lenin said, war is terribly profitable. On the home front, there are many reports in the Belfast newspapers giving evidence of corruption regarding the increase in rents, fuel prices, food prices, and the minutes of the Belfast Trades Council during that period give examples of records of the fight that the trade unionists were putting up against these. And you just have to read it because they were really taking advantage. And I think in Glasgow, they were quite successful in the rent strike that they had there. But in the final instance, the left was split. Many who had voted in 1912 at the conference to support against war actually supported the patriotic call of their national governments. Socialist internationalism collapsed in August 1914 as the leading left-wing parties in Britain, Germany, France and Austria and Hungary signed up to political truces and allowed their leading members to take part in the joint coalition governments. So the present, where stands the left today? And I said I weren't going to answer this question because it's really a difficult one, you know. I mean, we're faced with a divided country and a divided community. The peace process, on the other hand, has allowed us to work openly for our objectives. You know, okay, we recognise the inadequacies of the Belfast Agreement, but nevertheless, we demand the full implementation of the agreement, including the Bill of Rights, the Civic Forum, and the recognition of the Irish language. You know, it's like It's really good to be here. I mean, I could say that maybe 25 years ago, we wouldn't have this kind of conference. We wouldn't have these kind of discussions. So it's good to really see these small things that are happening. And it is a process. It's not something that's going to happen all at once. We all, of course, acknowledge that sectarianism is a major issue, and racism is equally so. The Communist Party of Ireland have short-term and long-term objectives. In the short term, we believe that the fight for better conditions to maintain standards of living is essential. The No to Water Charge campaign is absolutely tremendous at this point in time, and it is going into a movement, and what happens there is really important. In the North, we should be supporting this as well. And the strikes in the public sector and the defence of the health service is really, really important. And the struggle to give the trade unions, women's organisations and community organisations the chance to work together and break down barriers. And this does happen. We can't say that it's all great, and but at the same time, some of these things, they do happen. In the long term, the unity of Ireland is a natural outcome for the island of Ireland. To be divided is uneconomical, it's impractical. The trains and the bus lines don't stop at the border. The banks and the Orange Order are all island institutions. And of course, our notion of a united country is one that guarantees the rights of women, that incorporates the best health service, and one where religion is a personal choice and not institutionalised, and a country that meets the economic needs of all the people. In terms of unity of action, I would say that some demands are ones that people have to support for survival. We have to eliminate tax evasion and avoidance, and the tax haven, as in the Republic. The British government have made a loss of 36 billion, but in actual fact, 120 billion is considered to be lost through tax evasion and tax avoidance. The reduction of corporation tax will only benefit big business, and any notion that jobs in the public sector should go in order to pay for this is totally shameful. We have to stop the National Health Service money being doled out to private health companies. In actual fact, we were at a conference today on this particular subject, and it was really some really good material coming out there. Finally, of course, the defence of water is a natural resource and shouldn't be privatised. It's just one of the environmental issues that everybody would be concerned with. Well, finally, we come back to the cost of war and the fact that war is still terribly profitable. A reduction in defence spending, I would say, is essential. They spend something like £1.7 trillion. I mean, that's an unthinkable amount of money that's spent. And small countries buying arms that, I mean, anyway, it's immoral for Britain and anybody to be spending money on arms when it can be spent on education and health. It's estimated that £9 billion was spent on the illegal mission in Afghanistan, to say nothing of the human costs. So these are not just issues to be won by the left, but ones that have to be won for humanity. So thank you very much. God bless you.
James Connolly proclaimed in 1915 that we live in extraordinary times. He was, of course, alluding to the conflict raging on the battlefields of Europe, the Great War, that which H.G. Wells would term the war to end all wars. A great calamity it most certainly was, the last, however, it most definitely wasn't. World War I and the preceding militarisation of Europe's imperial powers in what was the first truly global arms race undoubtedly set the context for Irish political life for a generation or more. Indeed, I don't think it's possible to imagine the Irish Revolution of 1912 to 1922 in isolation of such cataclysmic events on the continent. Although in reflection, this should come as no surprise. International events have a tendency to reverberate loudly in an Irish context. It was American and French revolutions that provided the enlightened flame for United Irishmen in the 1790s. Mazzini's cultural nationalism had enthused Thomas Davis and Young Ireland in the 1840s. And even more recently in the 1960s, worldwide demands for civil rights and the victorious anti-colonial victory spelt disaster for an Orange state. In 1914, the imperial powers assembled more than 60 million soldiers, both men and boys, on battlefields throughout Europe. By 1918, nearly 10 million were dead. Some 25 million more were severely wounded, and four of the continent's ancient empires had been vanquished. As the Allied victors sat down to share out the lands of their former enemies, Europe was, in the words of the Czech Thomas Masaryk, now a laboratory atop a vast graveyard. In the space of little more than a year, they had drawn new borders in Ireland, Yugoslavia, and large swathes of the Middle East. To the eternal shame of the empires, the people trapped inside these pseudo-borders, from Belfast to Sarajevo, from Beirut to Baghdad, have been locked in deadly conflict for much of the last century. It's with little surprise, then, that Irish citizens have, by and large, struggled to effectively remember and make sense of the First World War in a wider international context. Too often, we have become blinded by what I term a debilitating dichotomy of right and wrong when it comes to discussing why Irish men fought and died in a British uniform. Many to this day simply cannot stomach the thought of young Irishmen dying on the fields of Flanders while the same British uniform and the same British army filled the Stonebreaker's Yard in Kilmainham Jail with the blood of Irish revolutionaries. It is my belief, however, that this philosophical cul-de-sac has disarmed progressive voices for far too long, because it's exactly the way the establishment in Ireland want us to look at World War I. They like it this way, for time and time again they get to package and repackage such events to suit the polemics of any particular era. We only have to look at the emerging, unquestioning nostalgia in recent months regarding Irish participation in World War I, and what appears to be some sordid accommodation of British establishment desires to recast the slaughter as a gallant fight against aggressive Prussian militarism, with more than a hint of a suggestion that this was some form of early Nazism. It simply wasn't. Moreover, this creeping nostalgia has required a substantial slice of Allied amnesia. As mentioned already here tonight, there is little mention of Belgium's brutal colonial record or the Tsarist tyranny in Russia. The imperial excesses of Britain, Japan, France and Italy are largely forgiven, as the need to move beyond traditional Irish enmities seems to be the official stance of the day. For in an age where the politics of commemoration reflect little more than the prostitution of the dead, we need to challenge such sordid attempts to glorify the despicable slaughter of millions in the First World War. The Irish political establishment have enthusiastically peddled the myth in recent years that Ireland somehow airbrushed such sacrifices from the national psyche. This is complete nonsense. When you consider that the World War Memorial in Dublin was completed more than 20 years before the Garden of Remembrance in 1967, it's perhaps more accurate to suggest that the Irish people have never forgotten the huge sacrifice in World War I, but rather we have remembered it as a colossal waste of life, with nothing glorious or nostalgic about it. Indeed, I think this is exactly how we should remember it, as a huge waste of life, lives that were given away so cheaply in the interests of the privileged elite and the capitalist owners of imperial industry. Be it a life given supposedly in the name of God and Ulster, or a life given for the name of little Catholic Belgium. Progressive voices in Ireland today should rightly remember that it was a strong, united rejection of imperialism and World War I that fueled the Irish revolutionary period and which ultimately discredited British rule in Ireland. We should be under no illusion that it is the same arrogance of power that filled European trenches with men in 1914 that has brought economic hardship to Europe in 2014. Just as a progressive alliance of Irish Labour and Republican voices stood against the imperial powers in 1914, we too must continue to build progressive alliances today against the worst excesses of the privileged elite. The left needs to enthusiastically come together around viable alternative political projects. Our opponents all too often find common ground with conservative forces in every corner of Ireland, and indeed ever increasingly in places such as London and Brussels. We must take them on together. Standing divided, we have too often let these conservative forces successfully obscure, obfuscate and obstruct. They outlive public outcry, and too often they cling on to power and privilege. Where once they led the youth of Ireland to their death in European trenches, today they leave our young people with little hope other than emigration. Huge issues that we face together, that we can stand together and challenge together, include, and some of them have been mentioned here tonight already, the water charges, the environment, energy and our natural resources, equitable economic recovery, adequate housing, women's rights, international issues such as Palestine, and the protection of public services such as health. These are all issues that we can stand together, united, and put differences aside to work for a way forward. In the north of Ireland, we have witnessed a devastating mismanagement of health budgets in recent years that has piled crisis on top of crisis and cut upon cut to frontline services. Moreover, for the best part of a generation, successive British governments have opened the door to increasing privatisation of the public healthcare system, as any notion of social welfare has been scrapped in favour of private competition. Listening to various British politicians, you would think that the NHS was a source of embarrassment, a cross they are no longer prepared to carry. Yet for millions of ordinary citizens, the NHS has transformed their lives, an astonishing vision of social solidarity, the very embodiment of the spirit of 45. The latest battleground for control of the public health system is the looming transatlantic trade and investment partnership, more commonly known as TTIP, a free trade agreement that is currently being negotiated between the unelected European Commission and the USA. Not only will an EU member state be legally obliged to implement TTIP, opening the door for American healthcare providers to bid for all government spending contracts, it would also empower private interests to sue national governments if they adversely affect future profit. Decades of struggle to enshrine workers' rights will be reversed in an instant as private profiteering will be embedded into the most precious of our public institutions. Of course, it didn't have to be this way. As a public service, the NHS would have avoided the worst excesses of TTIP, but the 2012 Health and Social Care Act seen to that. Conveniently, the NHS is no longer conforms to the traditional description of a public service. David Cameron's 2010 vision of the NHS becoming a fantastic business for Britain can now be implemented. For David Cameron and the Conservatives, the economic growth of private interests is evidently more important than the well-being of the citizens who simply cannot afford a privatised health system. The political establishment and their media moguls tell us there are brave decisions to be made, hard medicine to be swallowed. But then again, how brave can you feel when it's children who suffer the most from the pangs of poverty? How brave is it to oversee the worst low-wage economy for young people since records began? How brave is it to cut the top rate of tax while hammering the disabled with cuts to vital welfare? With more billionaires in Europe now than before the banking crisis emerged, inequality is rife and a sense of alienation increasingly consumes any notion of social solidarity. This sense of alienation, a psychological frustration at being constantly the victim of forces beyond our control, has begun to rapidly eat away at the very sense of social being in Europe today. But it doesn't have to be this way. There are choices to be made. Progressive change is possible, but it will take yet an untapped cohesion within the left to transpire. But we must begin to believe that we can deliver real and viable alternatives together, that we can set aside philosophical differences and theoretical points of departure in the interests of the people we represent. The focus tonight has largely been on Connolly's maxim that we serve neither King nor Kaiser but Ireland. But I'd like to finish perhaps with another fitting remark from Connolly, a maxim that I think, that I believe should be the forefront of all our minds. He said, "Our thinking must not be a morbid idealism of the past, but capable of formulating a distinct and definite answer to the problems of the present, and a political economic creed capable of adjustment to the wants of the future. If we as progressives are to build an Ireland that truly serves neither King nor Kaiser, then we must not grow idle in the shade of the past. We must work together, for we too live in extraordinary times." Gordon Murgut.
As a young person here tonight, what do you make of the debate?
It was very interesting, touched on a lot of relevant points. Obviously, you know, how we commemorate the people that fought in 1914 and since that, and talking about, you know, opening up a space for everybody to commemorate the people. Like, lots of Irish people had relatives who died there and aren't even aware of that, or why they fought, or why they died. And talking about that is a good starting place to doing something positive about it, as opposed to having this another sectarian debate about it. You know, it's another thing that excludes certain people and makes certain people feel like they're not part of the state.
The wider debate about the relevance of the left today, and especially trying to achieve a new Ireland, how important is that?
Well, I mean, that topic and the concept itself is explored very well, I think, here by a couple of the speakers. I mean, in the north, when there's a lot of sort of division over orange and green issues, the left on issues of progressivism have potential to unite. the youth and the working class like no other. And particularly in the south, where there has been a lot of austerity for the past couple of years, there's a growing importance there for a strong left axis, and Sinn Féin is obviously set to be at the front of that.
Chris Hazard, a very interesting debate. What did you make of it yourself?
I thought it was good. We just didn't bog ourselves down in the past. I was looking at the events of World War One, the militarisation of the imperial powers, and how this same arrogance of power, we see it in Europe today, we see it in the political establishment in London and Dublin today. So it's great to have a real alliance of people from the left coming together, Republicans, Communist Party members, trade union members, coming together to talk about the political issues that we face today and what we need to do to overcome them.
How important is it that this debate goes national and in a very real way tries to build the left-wing alliance that Sinn Féin's advocating?
But it's crucial. You know, we see that our political opponents, conservative forces, they're very good at building alliances, obscuring and obfuscating and really putting barriers up to reform of our systems. We see it in education all the time. We see it in our economy now. We see it whenever Sinn Féin are calling for equitable and progressive reforms of the system, that our conservative opponents pull together to stop this. I think what we're seeing here tonight is a message from all those on the left that we too need to stand together and work with the one interest.